Welcome, John.
I certainly appreciate the invitation to speak to you this morning. I want to say that it brings back some memories. Back in 1978, I visited Dr. Roth just next door here. I believe it was in Griggs Hall. And I came for counsel. I felt that God had given me what I've referred to sometimes as an epiphany. That the flood had to be a tectonic catastrophe. So it's a topic I'm going to be talking about. And my problem was that I had zero training in earth science. My training up to that point had all been in electrical engineering. And I felt like it was this understanding that somehow I had acquired was extremely important in defending the flood. And so I went to Professor Roth to get his advice and counsel, and shared with him, you know, what my conclusions were. And he actually encouraged me. I couldn't imagine God wanting me to do something. My prayer was, I was sort of asking God, why don't you show a Christian geologist what you've shown me? But anyway, the outcome was that I ended up leaving Campus Crusade for Christ. The reason I was in the area, I was at their headquarters up at Lake Arrowhead at the time, and I'd been invited to come there for a year to work to try to make some of the materials that I'd been using in lectures on the creation evolution issue accessible and available to other Campus Crusade staff members. And during that year, I had some time to look at some of the more difficult issues that I had not had time to look into that much prior to that year. And one of them was, where does this new concept of plate tectonics fit into the flood? And as I looked into that, I realized that primarily because all of the ocean floor today is young relative to the fossil record, that the flood logically had to involve a large-scale plate tectonics. So anyway, I'm grateful for the counsel that Dr. Roth gave me and pushed me a little bit to get a PhD in earth science, which I did at UCLA. And God opened some unbelievable doors to me after that. One of them, was just the opportunity to do my PhD at Los Alamos, having access to a brilliant mathematician who had just the numerical method needed to be able to do this, to be able to calculate flow in the Earth's interior in three dimensions, plus the supercomputers there, access to the supercomputers. So I will share some of that goes back to those days of my PhD thesis, show some of the results from the code I developed then, still apply to modeling the flood, and hopefully encourage you your faith in God's word that the flood was a very real event, the most significant event since creation as far as the physical history of the earth is concerned. Now, my motivation back then, and it still continues to be, is the ferocious assault that has been going on for a long time, probably from the very beginning. If you look back to Genesis 3, it appears that it was going on back in those days. Satan's first words was, "Has God said?" calling into question what God had said. And so that has not ceased. That's one of Satan's primary tactics, is to call into question the word of God. But the last 200 years, there's been, I believe, a major assault a satanic assault on biblical authority. And at the heart of this strategy is the idea that the earth is ancient, millions and billions of years old, and right off the bat, if you accept that framework, there is no place for a global flood. So that perspective eliminates the possibility of a global flood, primarily because if you look at the last few thousand years for when the biblical flood would have occurred, according to scripture, according to the genealogies, there's simply no physical evidence for any global scale catastrophe within that time frame. So the primary deception of the last days is alluded to in 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 3 through 6, where Peter says, "In the last days, mockers will come with their mocking, following after their own lusts, and saying, 'Where is the promise of His coming, Christ's coming?'" The reason for rejecting that, they say, "For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation." So they're asserting what is now known as uniformitarianism, that all continues just as it was from the beginning, no interruptions in the natural cause and effect laws of nature order to the way the world works. And Peter then goes off in the next verse, goes on to say that when they take that position, they are being willfully ignorant that of two events in the past: creation, first of all, and secondly, the flood. When the Bible indicates that God intervened physically in the material realm, and so I believe that as innocent as those words may sound, all has continued just as it was from the beginning of creation. That is Satan's the great deception of the last days, and it's so serious because it calls God's word, the first 11 chapters of Genesis, into question. It renders it basically destroys the authority of the Bible. And so many people, especially in the academic world, have been taken in by that deception. And again, I would say one of the strongest evidences against it is the evidence of a global world-destroying flood. And so God's called me to invest my life in seeking to defend the reality of the Genesis flood. And that's my topic today. I'm going to begin with some evidences that the flood indeed was a global cataclysm, clear evidences, physical evidences for global scale cataclysm. And then I will, even though many of these evidences are hydrological, involving water, I want to then move on and look at the evidences for tectonic catastrophism and share a little bit of the modeling that I've done and evidences that such a cataclysm is from a physics standpoint is defensible, is plausible, defensible, and that there is also evidence for a recent turnover of the Earth's mantle, convective turnover. Okay, so let's see if this thing works. Just in way of review, let's look at what the scripture has to say about the flood. Just a few select verses out of Genesis chapters 6 and 7. Chapter 6, verse 11, "Now the earth was corrupt in the sight of God, and the earth was filled with violence." Then God said to Noah, "The end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence because of them, fallen man. And behold, I'm about to destroy them with the earth." So God emphasizes his destruction of the earth in this passage. "Behold, I am bringing the flood of water upon the earth to destroy all flesh in which is the breath of life from under heaven. Everything that is on the earth shall perish." And then in chapter 7, verse 11, "In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the 17th day of the month, on the same day, all the fountains of the great deep burst open, and the floodgates of the sky were opened, and the rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. Verse 19, "The water prevailed more and more upon the earth, so that all the high mountains everywhere under the heavens were covered. All flesh that moved on the earth perished, birds, cattle, beasts, and every swarming thing that swarms upon the earth, and all mankind, of all that was on the dry land, all in whose nostrils was the breath of the spirit of life, died. Thus he blotted out every living thing that was upon the face of the land, from man to animals to creeping things and to birds of the sky, and they were blotted out from the earth, and only Noah was left together with those that were with him in the ark. And the water prevailed on the earth 150 days. So my claim is that if a person takes these words at face value, there's no escape that this from the conclusion that this was a global cataclysm, that essentially that wiped out all the air-breathing, land-dwelling life on the earth except what was preserved in Noah's Ark. And certainly this kind of cataclysm would have left evidence behind. So what kind of evidence would one expect from what we just read? Well, certainly wouldn't be surprising to find a lot of sediment layers on the continent, and sediment layers containing billions of dead things. And indeed, we do find this layer cake pattern of sediments on the continental surfaces. And this is a cross section of the geological record running north-south through the Grand Canyon up into Arizona. You see the Grand Canyon there on the right-hand side, and more than 15,000 feet of sedimentary rock with essentially no internal erosional channeling, very little internal erosional channeling. It was layer after layer in a continuous sequence, not large spans of time that would have resulted in internal erosion of these interfaces between the layers. And we have an abundance of fossils in these layers, all kinds of fossils, starfish, ammonites, swimming marine reptiles, and so on. Moreover, the onset of this cataclysm was abrupt and violent, and it left its mark in the rock record as a global discontinuity known as the Great Unconformity. I'm going to talk a moment about that. This unconformity is beneath the first fossils of multicellular organisms that are found. It's just below what's called the Cambrian explosion, also just beneath the appearance of the so-called Ediacaran fossils. And essentially 23 of the 23 phyla of animals that are found in the rock record are preserved in these Cambrian strata. So it's there's absolutely no time for the evolution and no candidates for ancestors to these 23 phyla. So this is a major problem for any kind of theory of evolution, the fact that all these animals appear suddenly on the scene. Okay, now where is this great unconformity? Well, if you go to the Grand Canyon, It's fairly easy to get to, moderate if you're willing to hike a little bit or take a raft down the river. It's at the base of a formation known as the Tapete Sandstone, which is indicated with by these green arrows. It's marked with great violence. This is a photo. This happens to be John Morris. He and I, we were both on a field trip back in the late 1980s, hiked down into the canyon, and the green arrow marks this great unconformity. Notice the size of the class in the Tapete Sandstone. Some of them several feet in diameter. And to imagine rock that coarse moved along by water over a huge scale, over actually a continental scale or even global scale. This is a rock a little further to the north in that same Tapete Sandstone from that previous photo. This is a boulder that's about 15 feet in diameter and weighs approximately 200 tons. They're marked with the green arrows in this same Tapete Sandstone at the base of the Tapete Sandstone. Last summer, I was in Wisconsin and able to see this same boundary, the great unconformity there in Wisconsin. And at this site, the underlying bedrock was quartzite, purplish quartzite, just like the quartzite that makes up those boulders in the Grand Canyon. The Shinumu quartzite, is it's called there in the Grand Canyon. You see the boulders above this horizontal interface here. These boulders are made out of the same stuff as this underlying quartzite. Huge pieces of that have been ripped up and laid down. So that's, again, evidence of just incomprehensible violence and catastrophism at the very onset of this cataclysm. And this is kind of rock is distributed throughout the world. My friend Steve Austin was in Jordan a few weeks ago, and the same kind of boulders, coarse material, is at the base of the Nubian sandstone there in southeastern Israel. Fairly easy to see. So this is the distribution of the Lower Cambrian Tapete Sandstone and its equivalents in North America. See that it girdles entire continent of North America. The portion there in the Canadian Shield, that area has been so heavily eroded in the flood. Even if this had been there, it has since been removed. So this is the Tapete Sandstone and its equivalents in North America, and we saw there in Wisconsin, where I was, it's very similar to what it is in Arizona. Okay. Another signature of global catastrophe: vast horizontal extent of the individual formations. We actually just saw that in that picture. These layers are very, very extensive. And another formation used to illustrate that is the Coconino sandstone, also very easy to see in the Grand Canyon. The arrows, one of the green arrows points the Coconino on the opposite side of the canyon, on the north rim of the canyon, just down from the rim. In the foreground, you see the Tapete Sandstone, and it's heavily cross-bedded, indicating high-velocity water transport. This is the lateral extent of the Coconino and its equivalents across Arizona, New Mexico, into Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas. This part shown here covers 200,000 square miles. This is a photo taken just on the north side of Interstate 40, about 65 miles east of Albuquerque. It's known as the Glorieta sandstone in New Mexico. Same as the Coconino, same cross bedding, same color, same kind of texture and grain size. Another signature of catastrophe is cross bedding. I've already alluded to that dune structure with individual sediment layers. A dramatic example of cross bedded sandstone is the Navajo. And it's conventionally believed to be wind deposited, but of course, if the fossil record is a record of the flood, it's impossible in the framework of the flood for this to be a wind deposited formation. It's a water deposited formation. A group that I'm associated with has spent about 8 years studying the Coconino and documented multiple lines of evidence that it's a marine deposited sandstone. I believe if that same kind of study were applied to the Navajo, it also would be demonstrated clearly to be a marine deposited sandstone. And this, to give you some idea of the kinds of dune structures that's preserved in the Navajo, this is a photograph of a feature known as the wave, where the Navajo sandstone has been eroded away to expose its cross-bedded structure. This is right at the Utah-Arizona border north of the Grand Canyon, and it's hard to imagine the size and speed of the water currents needed to generate these kind of dune structures. This is a photo from within Zion National Park, showing the 2,300 foot high cliffs. Again, it's hard to imagine such a vast sheet of sand, this Navajo sandstone that once stretched from Southern California to Central Wyoming and from Idaho to New Mexico. There's enough sand there to bury the state of Texas to a depth of 285 feet. So we're talking about cataclysm, a movement of sediment deposition beyond what the human mind can comprehend here. This is another shot in Zion National Park showing the cross beds in this thick deposit of sand. This is a little diagram showing how this cross bedding takes place. In the lower diagram here, by the way, it's got the vertical is it's exaggerated in the vertical direction compared to the horizontal. Anyway, as the water goes over the top of a dune, there's a little vortex forms on the front of the dune, allows the water velocity along here to drop to zero in effect, and allows the sediment grains to deposit. So there's deposition on the front side, erosion off the top, and you get these inclined beds, as you see here. And then if the current changes direction, or changes speed, these layers can be beveled off flat, and the process repeat. So this has been well studied in the laboratory, and it's possible to get the water depths and the current velocities by studying the geometry of these beds. Okay, another signature. I need to be moving a little faster here. Mass kills of large animals. This is from Dinosaur National Park near just east of Vernal, Utah. Large chunks of dinosaurs all jumbled up, buried together. You can see that the bones are still articulated here, but here this spinal column abruptly ends. And so there's several hundred dinosaurs buried together and catastrophically torn apart as they were buried there. So And that is in the Morrison Formation. The Morrison Formation also has large lateral extent, as you see here, extending from some central New Mexico all the way up into Canada. And a lot of the trophy dinosaur skeletons that have been found in the Morrison Formation. It also contains a lot of volcanic ash, and it's strongly suggests there were super volcanoes going off in probably in the Sierra Nevada, what became the Sierra Nevadas to the west, and dumped thousands of maybe millions of cubic miles of volcanic ash that got washed in with this material that formed the Morrison rocks. And those rocks have brilliant colors, very distinctive, easy in the field to spot from a distance, that Morrison layer. All right, moreover, to demonstrate that all this is recent, in 2005 there was this article in Science published by Mary Schweitzer reporting flexible blood vessels containing red blood cells in bone from a Tyrannosaurus rex from Montana. You see these blood vessels still in such a good state of preservation, they were flexible, and inside these red blood cells. So it's hard to imagine that even that state of preservation, even for 4,000 years, certainly not, it's just impossible to imagine for that state of preservation would last for 68 million years. Okay, another signature of catastrophe, huge volumes of buried trees. This is the Powder River Basin coal seam in northern Arizona, southern Montana, probably the most valuable body of coal in the country, low sulfur, a lot of it gets exported. The seam is about 90 feet thick right here, and it's material that has been transported in. It did not grow there. And this is another shot of the face where it's being strip mined. And so again, speaking of cataclysm, it's hard for us to even comprehend. I've already alluded to this situation, the flat contacts between major sedimentary units showing little or no erosional channeling, and that's the norm. It implies that deposition was rapid and nearly continuous. So if you look at these interfaces between these layers, there's very, in almost all cases, it's a very flat contact. It's very much in contrast with the Earth's surface today, which is heavily channeled. And Grand Canyon's a good example. We don't see these kind of features to speak of within this sediment record. And it's possible to see this interface on the Bright Angel Trail right in the Grand Canyon. This is a photo of a knife-edge sharp contact between the Coconino sandstone above and the Hermit Shale below. Also note that the crossbeds come in at an angle right to this contact. To me, that's really, really amazing. So a final example here is the amount of material that has been stripped away after this record was deposited. We have little islands of sediment out to the south here, and indicating that these same layers were continuous much further toward the edge of the continent. But at some point in geological history, were stripped away. All the sediment was stripped away, moved to the continental shelves. The only time that makes sense in terms of the flood is the runoff time of the flood, when the flood waters were moving off of the continents back into the ocean basins. So incredible volumes of sediment stripped away during that process. So an obvious implication of the biblical account of the flood is that a staggering amount of geological change took place in the span of only a single year. Given this reality, do we have any clues as to what some of the main causal mechanisms might have been? Well, I'm scheduled to speak here in 2 weeks, and I'm going to talk about what some modeling work I've done recently on trying to model how so much sediment can be moved around in the course of a single year on the where the average sediment thickness is about 6,000 feet on the continents. How can that much sediment be eroded, transported, and deposited in just a few months' time? I'm going to be sharing a computer model that I developed that seeks to model that and to give some insight just what is needed to drive water that strongly to be able to carry that much sediment. I'm not going to talk about that today, so if you're interested, you can come back in a couple of weeks. What I'm going to focus on today is another aspect, a causal mechanism, and that is the tectonic, the mechanism behind all the tectonic change, the clues from that, we've focused on, up to now on the what we see on top of the continents. We're going to shift for a moment to what we find on the ocean bottom, and the tectonic implications. Based on several different methods, it has been found that the crustal rock beneath all the ocean basins is younger than a large portion of the continental fossil-bearing sediment record. So we see here a National Geographic map showing the topography of the Atlantic Basin with the Mid-Atlantic Ridge prominently running down the middle here. And also it's pretty clear how it's easy to imagine these pieces fitting back together to form a single larger continent. And then this Atlantic Basin opening up and moving North and South America away from Africa and Europe. Okay. So how does new ocean crust form? Well, ocean crust is basalt, roughly 5 to 7 kilometer thick layer of basalt. It's a product of partially melted mantle rock. So as these plates, lithospheric plates, move apart, there's material, rock material, solid rock material that rises up from below to fill the gap. And because of the melting temperature of this rock depends on pressure. As it experiences lower pressure, the melting point becomes lower, and some of the minerals can find themselves above their melting temperature and begin to melt. So not all the minerals melt. Some of them have higher melting temperatures, but the ones that do melt produce this special kind of rock known as basalt and produce typically a layer of about 6, 5, 6, 7 kilometers thick as this process unfolds, and much of it forms dikes, narrow lenses of rock, and this rock is cooled by circulation of ocean water, so this freezes and becomes a layer of basalt. Okay. So that's how new ocean crust is formed. The process is generally known as seafloor spreading. And it occurs along these segments of a mid-ocean ridge system that are commonly offset by faults. So this is when we talk about a mid-ocean ridge, that's what we're talking about. This is what's going on with the mid-ocean ridge. It's caused by the lithospheric plates pulling apart along that seam, if you will. So all the basaltic ocean crust on Earth today has formed since this point in the continental sedimentary record. Basically, all of it is younger than Permian. This would represent the Permian-Triassic boundary, and actually the oldest ocean floor is actually higher up in the Permian. So this is being a conservative here. This arrow could be up about this point. So that means that all the fossil-bearing rocks below this point that would have been laid down during the flood occurred before any ocean floor that we have on Earth today was formed at a mid-ocean ridge. And it was this realization that prompted me. I realized this was big back in 1978 when I came down to talk to Dr. Roth about what to do. So, all right, so what does this mean? Well, that the present-day ocean floor is so young. Well, it means, for one thing, that all the pre-flood ocean floor has vanished from the face of the earth, all of it. And all the present ocean crust is formed since the onset of the flood, or actually more like, more or less, the midpoint in the flood. All the present ocean floor has been created at a mid-ocean ridge since sometime in the middle of the flood. Logical implication is that the continents, for one thing, the continents have migrated by thousands of miles across the face of the earth during the flood. And in other words, the flood not only involved hydrological catastrophism, it also involved tectonic catastrophism. In other words, based on the age of the ocean crust relative to the continental fossil record, the opening of the Atlantic Ocean must have occurred during the flood. All of this displacement of North America away from Africa and Europe must have occurred during the flood. Same for South America and Africa. So a lot of people, their knowledge or their understanding of the flood goes back to when they were probably 4 years old, in their Sunday school or Sabbath school class, the teacher taught them this little song about the rain's coming down, the flood's coming up, somewhat of a rather tranquil event. And so in most people's minds, that's the kind of mental picture they have for the flood. But if you look into the geology a bit, if you even take the biblical text seriously, it had to be a much, much more violent event than that, much more catastrophic event, as we've been looking at. All right, the understanding that rapid large-scale tectonic change must have been a key aspect of the Genesis flood has come to be known as catastrophic plate tectonics. This conceptual framework, actually, it was hinted at in a book published in 1858 by Antonio Schneider Pellegrini, who lived in France. He's from of Italian background, and he wrote a book on creation and the flood, and. He had maps in there showing the opening of the Atlantic Basin, a map with South America joined to Africa, and North America joined to Europe, and then a subsequent opening of the Atlantic Basin. Now, Schneider was a creationist, so he could be credited with this idea of catastrophic plate tectonics. Of course, they didn't know about the tectonic plates in those days. So the framework was first introduced and discussed at the first international conference on creationism held in Pittsburgh in 1986 that really included the plate tectonics aspects of it. What are some of the highlights of this process of catastrophic plate tectonics? Well, before we get into that, let's have a brief tutorial on what the structure of the Earth's interior is like. Basically, you can divide the Earth into two main parts, the core and the mantle. The core is, most of it is understood from seismology to be liquid iron. There's a small inner core that's solid. But the rest of the core is in the liquid state. It does not support the propagation of shear waves, seismic shear waves, where the motion is this way. Liquids don't support that kind of shear. And so more than 100 years ago, it was concluded that the outer core, at least, was liquid. The mantle is silicate and is solid rock, except from some very localized situations where a little bit of partial melting takes place, like under a mid-ocean ridge or adjacent to a subduction zone or where there's a hot spot and an ocean island being formed. So anyway, you have the two main parts of the Earth, liquid core, solid mantle, and then two other parts I want to emphasize is this cold outer layer that's strong because it's cold. It's known as the lithosphere, and the plates, the lithosphere is broken up into roughly a dozen large plates. So plate tectonics involve the motions of these semi-rigid blocks of lithosphere over the face of the Earth. Just below the lithosphere is what's called the asthenosphere, which is a layer of extremely weak rock. Atheno is from the Greek for weak, so it's various lines of evidence indicate that layer's on the order of 1,000 times weaker than the lithosphere. Maybe in some places it's even weaker than that. So it allows the plates to move more or less freely over the surface of the Earth, such that the drag forces on the bottom are negligible. The forces moving the plates are the forces acting at their edges, and the drag on the bottom is understood to be is almost certainly negligible. Which, by the way, allows the Pacific plate to move to be 6,000 miles wide and move as a coherent body without ripping apart. It seems that requires there be essentially no drag on the bottom. Okay, catastrophic plate tectonics is similar to conventional plate tectonics, except that the plate velocities are about 1 billion times higher. And so during the flood, these plates moved at about 5 miles per hour instead of about 2 inches per year as they do today. And it can occur because rock comprising the mantle weakens under stress. I'll get into that a bit more. And this provides the potential for a runaway catastrophe. So just how much continental motion occurred during the flood? Well, the following images summarized how the continents have moved just since the time when the supercontinent Pangaea existed, as reconstructed by the secular earth science community. And these images were produced by Professor Ron Blakey of Northern Arizona University, available online. So this is we're going to start here in the early Triassic. That's the point where, since this time, all of the present-day ocean floor has formed by seafloor spreading. So all the continental area was adjacent, as you see here. This is an attempt to reconstruct it. All right, so moving forward in time from this point, you see an opening first of the North Atlantic, and then a breakup of the southern continent, opening of the South Atlantic, and Ice Age, and essentially no motion since the Ice Age to the present. So let me go back and through that again. So we're talking about all of this motion occurring during the year of the flood. So. One thing at I understood the need to do this. So one of my goals when I went to UCLA was to develop a computer model that could model flow inside the Earth and potentially, hopefully, be able to model that process, the movement of the tectonic plates. All right, with fossils being the indicator of geological activity associated with the flood, all the plate motion shown in the preceding sequence must have accompanied the flood and unfolded in the span of a few months' time. Just repeating myself there. Catastrophic plate tectonics, like conventional plate tectonics, accounts for many of the Earth's physical features, including the mid-ocean ridges, which we've looked at, the deep ocean trenches, the global distribution of earthquakes, volcanism adjacent to the trenches. We've already seen this. So in both catastrophic plate tectonics in conventional plate tectonics, we have mid-ocean ridges accounting for the moving apart of the plates in the ocean basin and the production of new ocean crust and new lithosphere. I didn't say much about what happens on the other side of the plate as the plates move apart. What occurs is what is called subduction, where the ocean plate plunges into the Earth's interior, and it results in earthquakes associated with this interface, also associated with the bending of the plate. It produces a deep trench, a deep ocean trench, where this plate plunges into the interior. If it happens next, one thing that occurs is that it carries a little bit of the sediment plus water down as it plunges down into the earth. And when it gets deep enough, the temperature gets hot enough, the water tends to lower the melting temperature, and you have melting rock producing magma which rises up and produces a zone of volcanoes. And since we have subduction basically around, much of the Pacific Rim, we also have volcanism around the Pacific Rim, which is known as the Ring of Fire. So we have this volcanism, we have the earthquakes, and a deep trench associated with the subduction of the plate into the Earth's interior. Okay. If we look at the distribution of earthquakes on the Earth, we find that most are associated with the plate boundaries. So especially with these boundaries where subduction is taking place, like along the western margin of South America and Central America, along the Aleutian Islands, along these trenches in the western Pacific, along the Java Trench, the Tonga Trench, these major earthquakes, but we also have earthquakes associated with the spreading ridges. So all of this, these are explained in both kinds of plate tectonics, catastrophic. If we look at the active volcanoes today, again, most of them are connected with subduction zones of subduction. And then there are also some hot spots producing ocean islands like Hawaii and Iceland and Tristan da Cunha and a place called Kerguelen. Well, lots of Canary Islands. So we have those hot spots. I won't say much more about that. All right, just to give you an idea that this concept of spreading and subduction really works. There's a little lava lake in northeastern Africa. It's only about 120 feet across, but you can see as this basaltic lava rises and cools at the surface. The air is cooling it. There's a place where it spreads apart. This is would be equivalent to a mid-ocean ridge, and as it cools and gets dense, it sinks and effectively subducts. So this is a well-understood process. Same process happens when you boil soup on the top of a stove. Okay, some distinctive geological consequences of catastrophic plate tectonics. So there are some things that distinguish catastrophic plate tectonics from conventional plate tectonics, things that are significantly different. And one difference is that the catastrophic version leads to supersonic steam jets that emerge from on the seafloor along 40,000 miles of rapidly spreading mid-ocean rift zones. And then intense global rain from ocean water that's entrained by these jets and lofted above the Earth into the stratosphere. So this shows is an attempt to just schematically show that when this lithosphere is moving, spread, these plates are moving apart at, say, 5 miles an hour or more, you have lots of molten rock in direct contact with seawater. And this leads to production of supercritical water, which, if there's any way for the pressure to get lower, it will flash to steam. With the lower pressure upward, pressure gradient going upward, that takes place almost immediately, and you produce, there's enough energy, thermal energy available for this steam to accelerate to supersonic velocity, 5 or more kilometers per second. So you have these incredible steam jets that have enough energy to penetrate up into the stratosphere, even as they're entraining a lot of liquid water with them, carrying that up into the stratosphere, which falls back to Earth as liquid water. No need to remove the latent heat to have it fall back as rain. You're taking seawater, lofting it up into the atmosphere, and it comes back as liquid rain. Okay. Some other things. We have an elevated sea level with significantly elevated sea level with catastrophic plate tectonics because of warmer rock being emplaced below the seafloor near a ridge. We also have strong up and down motions of the continent surfaces because of rapid flow of rock inside the Earth. So the continents are moving up and down in response to the flow beneath them. And then there's another final difference, and that's dramatic uplift of today's mountain belts at the end of the cataclysm. And this is a powerful evidence in support of catastrophic plate tectonics. I'll say a little bit about that in a moment, that a major difficulty is why, if the plate tectonics had gone on for tens of millions of years, say under the western edge of South America, why didn't the Andes start rising earlier? Why did they wait until just almost the time of the Ice Age to rise? Well, if all of that subduction happened briefly in the time of a year, it's understandable. And when those driving forces went away, isostatic adjustment kicked in. This buoyant material which had accumulated, this thickened crust which had accumulated, bobbed up like a cork after the cataclysm. And so that's a big difference between conventional plate tectonics and catastrophic plate tectonics. So this is a little cartoon attempts to illustrate some of these points. Have again, the steam jets coming up, entraining ocean water, coming down as intense rain. You have a lot of hot rock rising here and being emplaced adjacent to the ridge. And that because the temperature is higher, its density is lower, it displaces a significant volume of ocean water, which raises the world sea level. You have this cold ocean floor sinking, and it sinks, it tends to pull down the edge of the continent where it's sinking. So that also increases the depth of water over that part of the continent. So you have all of this going on during this episode of catastrophic plate tectonics. This is a shot of the Chilean Andes. As I mentioned, one thing that happens after the catastrophe is the rock, the volcanic rock that's been in place, plus just the mechanical thickening of the edge of the continent, that material is buoyant, and during the catastrophe was held down, but when those driving forces went away, it because of its buoyancy rose up to produce these many places 20,000 foot high mountains. And that's true of all the high mountain ranges today, the Alps, Himalayas, the Rockies, as well as the Andes. And then a final point, a thing that occurred as a result of catastrophic plate tectonics is an ice age following the flood. The warming of the oceans during the flood led to high rates of evaporation, precipitation, and rapid buildup of polar ice sheets and mountain glaciers in the centuries following the flood. See the distribution of the ice sheets during the ice age. And this would have happened in the centuries, probably a couple of centuries or so after the flood. The warm water, the oceans were heated during the flood. Lots of evaporation after the flood. A lot of water carried to the high latitudes, more snow falling in the winter than could melt in the summer. Rapid buildup of ice sheets and producing these what's generally alluded to in secular in the secular framework as the ice ages. Okay, a crucial issue though is how can ocean plates sink vertically through 1,800 miles of mantle rock, of solid mantle rock, in a few weeks' time? So we have, in the case of catastrophic plate tectonics, plates sinking at meters per second, a couple of meters per second, or 5 miles an hour, down through the mantle, and able to penetrate this 1,800-mile thick layer in just a few weeks' time. Well, the basic answer is that mantle rock weakens under stress. Decades of laboratory experiments have demonstrated that. And an example of some of the equipment that's been used to study how silicate minerals deform under various temperature conditions and stress conditions. This is an experimental setup in Paris. This is an oven to control the temperature very carefully. The sample is in the center here, and stress is applied to it by these aluminum rods. And so that you can apply so much stress, you can see how the sample deforms with time during the experiment. And then afterward, you can examine the deformed sample under electron microscope, look at what has happened. And in the top image, the planes of atoms have slid over one another like a deck of cards that has been sheared. And so you get these kind of images are available to see, just to deduce just what the mechanisms were, exactly what happened at the atomic scale to allow these crystals to deform. Sometimes the deformation can be in two directions, and you get more a pattern that looks like this lower one here. So all of this has been well studied, it's been possible to plot this data on a single diagram like this, called a deformation map. And in this case, it's for the mineral olivine, which is the dominant mineral in the upper mantle. And so you can come up with there's a lot of experimental data available. And the this range right here, this, by the way, is the rate of deformation, the creep rate. I won't try to define all these terms, but this regime is accessible in the laboratory. And this is the regime that would have been in operation during the flood, these kind of rates right here. So we have laboratory data in the range that would apply to the flood. Now, over the years, one of the things I've done is put together computer models for modeling these processes. And in particular, I'm able to take the deformation map there, represented in mathematical form, put it into a computer code, and look at what happens. This, I'm going to show just a brief animation in a moment. This is a box here that has a height equal to the thickness of the Earth's mantle, with a cold material on the top, hot material on the bottom. And in this particular case, just to get things going, I put a blob of cold material at the top and a blob at the bottom, and just let it go. And already at this point, the velocity is up to 4 meters per second. And so it just in a matter of days, that those blobs go to the opposite boundary. This is after 5 days. This is after 15 days. This is after 40 days. Note the energy driving this process is simply the gravitational potential energy associated with the initial temperature differences. So there's just like a weight held above a table. There's potential energy in it. If you release the weight, it falls, hits the whatever it is at the bottom beneath it, turns that kinetic energy into heat. The same way, the negative buoyancy here, the positive buoyancy here, is what drives the flow. There's no need for any outside energy to drive the flow. All right, so this is a little animation showing that process, before this takes place, the mantle has its strength that we observe today, and the plates would be moving at only inches per year. But because of this weakening, there's the potential for runaway, and in this case, runaway indeed takes place. All right. This 2D simulation, although it may not seem that complex or impressive, demonstrates that the physics indeed works, specifically that stress weakening in rocks can produce catastrophic consequences in a planet with a gravity field of the Earth. Gravity is a body force acting on these temperature differences, on these buoyancy differences. So it's a force that acts on every parcel of the material and is able to lead to this kind of catastrophic behavior. Now, in my PhD thesis, I developed a 3D model for the Earth's interior. This is the grid that I used. In this case, this particular refinement has about 1 in 1/3 million cells in it. Earth's mantle is divided up in about 1.3 million cells. I can now run this on my laptop, whereas this was too big to run on the biggest computer at Los Alamos when I was there. So, and I know there's some academics here. For your benefit, I put in what the equations look like that I'm solving. Just the conservation of momentum, mass, and energy. And so essentially that's the equations that this program solves. I start with a Pangean configuration of the continents for this calculation I'm going to show you in a moment. The early Jurassic time. This is my representation of the continental configuration. I put a zone of cold material around much of the margin, plus this piece of cold material here. So I don't know what the internal temperature structure of the Earth was at this point in Earth history. So I used just a simple approximation, very crude, simple approximation shown by the blue temperature. This is a slice through the equator. It only goes down 400 kilometers. So otherwise, the mantle's temperature is laterally uniform. So just with that little bit of initial trigger, a little perturbation, the plates start moving. The mantle starts moving, and this is an animation. Color denotes temperature, and the temperature basically goes from about 400 degrees Kelvin to 2,000 degrees, and this is at a depth of 65 kilometers, and you see this cold material at the edge pulling the continents apart, and the opening of the Atlantic Ocean, the Indian Ocean. It's a very crude calculation, but the plates basically end up going in approximately the right directions. And they're moving at, on the order of a meter per second or so. So this motion, the opening of the Atlantic Basin, takes place in a matter of a couple of months' time. Okay, so that's a view near the surface. Let's take a look at what the motion looks like. This is a slice through the equator. You see the cold material at these subduction zones. Sinking down and covering the base of the mantle. and have hot material ending up beneath the surface here in these oceanic areas that's going to cause the sea level to rise at the surface. Let's see, I'm almost out of time here. This is a view from the North Pole. Same picture near the surface. This is a view from the South Pole. Okay, and this particular view shows the water depth, and the purple line is sea level, and so here South America is almost completely flooded, gets almost completely flooded. The part of Africa near where the seafloor spreading is taking place tends to remain high and would be subjected to very severe erosion. So anyway, that's possible to pull out of the calculation what the flooding is like. All right, so I'm almost finished. I know I'm running a bit over here. Feel free to leave if you have to. Seismic evidence. Is there any evidence for a recent episode of catastrophic plate tectonics? Well, the answer is yes. Seismic images of the mantle reveal a ring of unexpectedly cold rock at the bottom of the mantle, beneath the subduction zones that surround the Pacific Ocean. This is a 3D image. The cold material, the blue represents cold material. This is from the Western Hemisphere, the Pacific Hemisphere. Here's Japan. Here's North America over here. This is from the Eastern Hemisphere. This is Africa. This is the same ring as you see here. On each side of the Earth, there's a blob of hot material shown in red being squeezed up like toothpaste in the center of this ring of cold material. And the big issue here is the temperature contrast between the cold and the hot. Based on the speed of seismic waves, it's inferred that temperature difference is about 3,000 centigrade or 5,400 degrees Fahrenheit. Huge. And the only way you could have that big of a temperature contrast and this not be melted is that this cold material be near the temperature of rock near the surface. In other words, plate material at the surface. What this implies is that there's been a very recent episode of subduction, as we saw here. This cold material get down here at the bottom very quickly, if the secular time frame were right, it would take at least 100 million years for material to get from the surface down to the bottom, and by that time it would have been heated considerably. Would not have that kind of temperature contrast. Okay. So another support, I'll just have to be very brief here, is the occurrence of what are called ultra high pressure minerals, such as coesite and diamond, from many tectonic belts around the world, testify to the reality of crustal rock like granite being subducted to depths of 100, 300, some cases 500 kilometers down, and then being rapidly brought back up to the surface before they got hot, so as to preserve the high pressure phase. And so this is evidence of something very dramatic having happened in the Earth's past, some very rapid tectonic activity. And then I've already pointed to the timing of the uplift of the high mountains around the world, testifying to a recent episode of rapid plate tectonics. So in summary, the Genesis flood was a global cataclysm that, in addition to hydrological processes that eroded and deposited kilometers of sediment in many places, also involved rapid plate tectonics, which subducted all the pre-flood ocean floor into the Earth's deep interior, generated all the present-day igneous ocean floor, and moved continents by thousands of kilometers across the face of the Earth. So in the century in which we lived, there are strongholds raised up against the knowledge of God. And right at the center, I have this one, uniformitarian geology. And so I believe all of these are related and need to be addressed, but the one I'm focusing on today is the flood being able to expose that deception as being false. And in that context, I'll just quote, close with this quote from 2 Corinthians, "Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of strongholds, destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God, taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ." I pray that that's your heart to be involved with. I believe we, if ever there was a time for us to be involved in the battle, it's today. So thank you for your attention.
It is now past 11:30, and I know some of you have to be elsewhere, so this is a good time to leave. For those of you who are staying and wish to show your appreciation for Dr. Baumgardner's coming here, we're going to try to cover his expenses, and so I'm going to pass the hat along. And for those of you who want notification of these kinds of programs in the future, I'm going to put up a cell phone number to text, and we'll add you to our list, which we don't share with anybody. Your email, and every week you'll get an announcement for what's coming up. This is the first time we packed the place, so. Maybe next time we'll try to see what we can do to change that. Or if for those of you who want to just simply write your email down, again, we plan to keep it confidential, as we have for since we've been having the list.
Yes.
And
it's
can either write it down or you can text it to the number that I'm going to put up on the board right away.
I'll just give it to you. Yeah, I can.
Can you write it?
Sure. Good stuff.
Okay. It's
as soon as we can, we're going to have a question and answer session for those of you who are still here.
Research.
Associates.org. And you. There's one that's, I think it says, our growing team or something. You'll click on it and find me, find my picture, and just drill down under my stuff. And it's
good luck. Good luck.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. I have a master's degree. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. I will look that up, and hopefully I can get in touch with you.
Okay.
Okay, now for those of you who have waited this long and have some questions, please raise your hand and we'll give you a mic to ask them. And then we'll Dr. Baumgardner will answer them until he gets tired of it.
Okay.
We have a
question
here. Okay.
I'm going to take my jacket off.
Okay, the first question would you consider plate tectonics still a theory, or is it its fact, or is it getting closer to being a fact?
Well, passing the hat around, you caught the people as they left.
Okay.
There's no fund from which we can invite these good men to come and share their wisdom. And he drove a long way, 100 miles from Ramona this morning. We don't need to have to walk home.
That's fine.
It's gotten.
All right. Art, the question here is plate tectonics only a theory at this point? What is the status of it? In my opinion, it's there's so many interlocking lines of evidence that seafloor spreading is real and subduction is real. I don't know of any other competitor today, any alternative.
I heard there was another theory out there of that the currents kind of carved their way through the turning of the earth, and this kind of thing would create that kind of shape on both sides due to the currents.
Well, you know, there are people that I would say that are not scientists that claim all kinds of things on the internet, but there are detractors in the creation community that, you know, don't want to accept it. But I've written some articles to try to answer some of these issues. I wrote an article last year, appeared in Journal of Creation, that points out that the GPS measurements today are just overwhelming, that the plates are moving, that the seafloor spreading is real, that subduction is real based on real-time GPS measurements. I mean, I don't know how much, you know, more convincing evidence a person would want than that. But nevertheless, there are people that, you know, say, well, I just don't accept it. Okay. I believe the evidence is overwhelming that seafloor spreading is real and subduction is real. The volcanoes and earthquakes, like the one that produced the big tsunami in Japan, you had about 25 feet of shortening of the Pacific basin when in that area where the Pacific plate in a big jerk plunged under Japan, produced the big tsunami. You know, if that isn't evidence of subduction, what better evidence would a person want? Okay.
We hear a lot more about subduction, much more so than the spreading of these plates. Are both compression and spreading taking place at the same time in various places?
Yes.
That would account for that.
Yes. NASA has a network of over 2,000 GPS stations around the world for trying to measure how the plates are deforming. You know, one important issue is earthquake forecasts. You know, with GPS, it's possible to find some places or get a much better idea of how the plates are deforming. The plates are, crystalline rock. They can deform elastically, just like a spring can be bent. And that's what happens that's what's going on along the San Andreas Fault, for example. Here in Southern California, the fault is locked. Basically because there's a big bend up north of Los Angeles, and the motion, it doesn't want to go around that curve, so the fault down here is locked, and it only moves through earthquakes, big earthquakes, but in central California, it's not locked, and so there are instruments measuring continuous motion of the San Andreas Fault in Central California at about 2 inches per year. So there you have instrumentation that is measuring it, you have GPS, you have other satellite technology that's able to measure the motion, the deformation of the crust.
How long have they been doing that? 10 years?
Before 2000, I'd say roughly since 2000. So 10, depending on the station, you know, 10 to 15 years. And the data is all online for every one of the 2,000 stations. So you can log on. It's all this is handled by the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, and they it's all real time. You can look at how these stations are moving as far as the GPS data.
We never had that data before, so now they can maybe see a pattern of movement and maybe even predict.
Yeah. Well, the pattern of spreading along the mid-ocean ridges and convergence at the subduction zones, that this GPS data is confirming that. Okay.
Okay, right
good,
here.
Those are good questions, yes.
Yeah. I've been corresponding with someone you know quite well, John Reed, Creation Research Society. He told me recently that you've shifted your opinions or beliefs on a certain subject, and that's where do we put the post-flood boundary?
No, it's other people. I've held to a late boundary.
Oh, okay.
For a long time.
For a long time. Because I thought when you and your colleagues published in 1994 as a result of the ICC meetings,
that paper,
it seemed like the publication put
that's right. In that
put the boundary at the Cretaceous Tertiary boundary.
That's right. And because we had some strong personalities, I didn't resist it at that point.
Oh, you didn't make it an issue.
Steve Austin and Andrew Snelling in particular were pretty strong on that point. One reason that I have held to a late boundary is that there is a lot of seafloor spreading that takes place in the Cenozoic.
True.
Okay? And you cannot get that large amount of seafloor spreading unless the mantle is weakened. And you don't get the weakening of the mantle without the runaway mechanism, with the actual rapid motion. So the fact that, so that means basically that this runaway had to end, and my guess is like the late Miocene or early Pleistocene. You can't put it down at the Cretaceous Tertiary boundary.
As you know, a lot of the evidence geologists, some of whom are here, put the end of the flood around the KT boundary, or maybe shortly thereafter, because we have what's called the Eocene formation there, the Green River formation, and there's a lot of evidence for things being formed somewhat in situ. Do you deal or do you interact at all with the paleontologists that are
I'm aware I'm aware of the debate about the Green River formation.
Okay, good.
And,
we're glad.
I've been there.
Good.
A couple of times.
Good. Keep looking.
I believe those layers were deposited rapidly. On one hand, they can't be annual.
There's, true.
Okay, mm-hmm. If you're going to take the Bible seriously, they can't be annual.
Right.
In the overall context of Eocene, there are I would argue there are evidences formations that have large lateral extent seem
right.
to certainly be catastrophic during the Eocene.
Good.
And so my view mainly driven but because of the tectonics is that the flood has to be after that point in the record.
So have you been able to pull, let's say, Steve Austin and Kurt Wise kind of your direction, or you have a variety of opinions
they,
on that stuff?
You know, I haven't beat them over the head, I'll say.
Good.
That. They're aware of the of my arguments.
I have 2 points. The first one is a statement, and the other one is a question. It seems that God in his mercy, even during the flood, had mercy on how the continents were formed, because it seemed like, I guess, if there was a flood, it seemed like the continents could have broken into little bitty pieces, and we had a bunch of islands. But my second question is, you talk or you spoke about the ocean. Has studies been done about the marine life and its contribution or its effect from the flood?
Well, I think probably people in this room have written on that. I'll just comment that part of my work at the National Laboratory, at Los Alamos National Laboratory, the last few years was I was working with a global ocean model, computer model for modeling the currents and the dynamics of the global ocean. And one aspect of the ocean is that it's very strongly stratified. Stratified by density. In other words, you have dense water, cold, dense water on the bottom. You have a low density surface layer it's low density because it's warmer, it's heated by the sun. It's also, in many places, it has fresh water input from rivers. Yeah, so that lowers the density in many places of the surface layer. So when you have a stratified fluid like that, it turns out that it's very hard to get the various water parcels to mix. It's not easy to mix a large volume of stratified fluid. So with that awareness, it's my conclusion that there were parcels of the pre-flood ocean water in which did not get heated or mixed, and that the marine life that was in those parcels could well survive. The salinity didn't change significantly, the temperature didn't change significantly, and so there are little blobs, if you will, of water that where life could more or less have survived without being greatly affected by the flood, during the flood.
Your presentation was interesting. Thank you for that. That was great. I got a question I don't think anybody can answer here, but it's a good question to think about. It says in this book what God's objective was for the flood. It was simply to wipe off the face of the earth, men and animals. And it kind of implies the face of the earth. Why would God kick the stuffings out of the earth to do that when he could just cause a storm? We are so frail as far as the earth goes in the universe, that why did he have to do such great catastrophic things to accomplish that purpose?
Okay, well, I think you'd probably have to ask him.
Well, that's why I said this is a good thing to think about, because I've read in the Bible that as far as might and power goes, that he's not too keen on that as far as calling people to worship him. So I was just wondering, if anybody has an idea.
Yeah, well, the words there I read out of Genesis 6, he's not only going to destroy mankind, but also the earth. So for some reason, he had reasons, and it was part of his predetermined plan to rework the surface of the Earth, it would seem. Just why, I suspect there are many, many, many things. For one, we have fossil fuel today. I think it's way beyond that. But so I'll just say I don't know.
In the back. Yeah, Dr. Baumgardner, thank you. Would this catastrophic plate tectonics model produce too much heat? And if so, has anyone been addressing that? And
yeah,
how would that be gotten rid of?
That is a problem in trying to explain what I presented today purely in terms of the known laws of physics. And specifically, that problem is cooling the ocean floor rapidly enough during the brief span of time. So in order to cool the ocean lithosphere to its present temperature, and to give it the present density that it has, there's got to be some other, as far as I can tell, supernatural removal of heat. That's the main place in my modeling that I have to appeal to something other than what just normal physics would yield. Well, it depends. In 2 Peter 3, one argument that Peter makes to refute uniformitarianism is that God acted in a supernatural way during the flood. So if I'm able to explain the flood without any supernaturalism, I'm probably the one in error. So I would say, on the other hand, I don't like being somewhat trained as a physicist, I don't like willy-nilly to invoke the hand of God every time it appears I might need to. But this point, it appears to me, I can conceive of no way to cool the present ocean lithosphere from near the melting temperature of basalt to the lower temperatures. On the order approaching 1,000 degrees centigrade for much of the ocean lithosphere today. The only way I can imagine is some kind of volumetric removal of that heat by God during the flood.
So if you had sort of subduction or rapid dropping of cool material, to explain the rapid motion of the continents during the flood, what about the earthquakes now? What do you see as the cause of that? Is this a momentum of the continents, or is it convection or lateral pressure?
Most earthquakes, I didn't use the term brittle, but word used in our community to refer to the lithosphere and rock near the Earth's surface, especially about the top 10 kilometers of crust, is that it acts in a brittle fashion. In other words, it's not ductile, brittle as opposed to ductile. And here in California, the earthquakes that we have generally involve the top 10 kilometers of the crust, which is cold and brittle. And generally, what keeps the fault locked are what are called asperities, little bumps along the fault. So currently the part of California west of the San Andreas is basically moving is coupled to the Pacific plate, which is moving to the northwest at, well, on the order of a couple of inches per year relative to the rest of North America. So every year where I live in San Diego, I'm 2 inches further to the northwest than Arizona. And so that displacement is being accommodated by elastic deformation of the rock. The rock the stress is increasing, the rock is deformed elastically, and as that continues to happen, the stress along the faults is continuing to increase. At some point, these asperities that are causing the fault not to move, to be locked, start breaking. And usually, if you can break and nothing happens, but when the key ones, when enough of them break, the fault fails, and there's a big jump. That's generally referred to as an earthquake.
Sir?
Yeah.
I'm not asking the cause, though, but I'm asking the cause for the motion of the continents. What's causing
all right. I'm sorry. Were there still residual motion? The main force that drives the plates is the weight of the plate down in the mantle. It's what is called slab pull. Another force is called ridge push, which is a result of the elevation of the plate near the ridge and the pressure that's implied by that higher elevation. All right, so there are forces acting today on the plates. The mantle interior, the mantle has a strength. So we have slow motion of the plates into the mantle today. And unless there is weakening, the strength of the mantle only allows about on the order of a few inches per year of motion. The rock away from the brittle crust is hot enough to deform ductally, and it is doing that. So there's the standard explanation for why we have earthquakes. I don't see any problem with that. I believe it's true. But yes, there is motion, and it's primarily a result of the weight of the subducted slabs pulling on the slabs today, causing them to move at a slow rate of speed, and this motion is measurable by GPS.
So, what computational language did you use to do your model?
I did this back in the early 1980s, and so I used Fortran. Yeah. Which, by the way, still if you're wanting the best efficiency from scientific computers, it still gives the best efficiency. The main reason is that in Fortran, you determine the layout of memory, how the memory maps to the computer hardware. And if you have a knowledge of how the hardware is designed, you can optimize your code to make the best use of the hardware. And so that's the reason that I used Fortran. That's the reason I continue to use Fortran to get the best performance. Other languages like C and C++, you do not have, the compiler decides how it's going to lay out your how it's going to map the memory of your program to the computer hardware. And in some cases it's not too bad, in other cases it's not so good. So there's still, and that's why still many scientific programs even today are written in Fortran.
Hi. In your model, okay, you have the floodwaters destroying all of the land animals, and you have plate tectonics occurring during that 150 days or so of the flood. My question is how do you explain the biodistribution of, say, the crocodile, which is located in Africa and South America, and the tapir, which is basically the same?
All right. Now, you, you need to distinguish between the distribution, the biogeographical distribution of the fossil animals and the animals, the current animals. As far as the fossil animals are concerned, that, you know, has long been a strong argument for plate tectonics, continental drift. The similarity, especially on the southern continents, of several types of fossil animals. I think it's called the Mesosaurus. There's a distinctive kind of reptile in South America, Africa, and India. Even before the 1960s, several geologists in the southern hemisphere were arguing that those southern continents had all been together because of the affinities of the fossil animals. That's one issue. Animals before the flood, it's plausible that you would find similarities across the continents that were joined together. Now since the flood, I think most of the issues have, I don't think there's much disagreement about that. The issues that concern us that are trying to defend the flood is the biogeographical distribution of animals today. And how did the marsupials, for example, so many of them get to Australia? And apparently, ended up there, and many of them not nowhere else. I don't think I have any better answers than, some of the people in this room. For one thing, the ice age lowered the sea levels by 300 feet or more, and did provide some land bridges. So there at least were ways for animals to get there after the flood because of the lowered sea level after the flood. Animals are pretty good at migration, traversing considerable distances. And so I think that after the flood, the earth was rapidly revegetated, so you had open territory to all these animals, and they took advantage of it. They reproduced rapidly. They migrated large distances in a few generations and were able to repopulate the earth in a relatively brief time. So that's not my specialty, so that's about all I can say.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Baumgardner. While we have you here, please, what is left for you to talk about 2 weeks from today? Can you give us a brief preview of what will be your lecture 2 weeks from now?
Okay. I still have this this title slide up, and it's a photo of the Grand Canyon. You see all those sediment layers. And what you're looking at is on the order of 5,000 feet of sediment. In many places, it's many times that on the Earth. And so these are fossil-bearing. Most generally, we're talking about the fossil-bearing part of the sediment record. How in the world can you transport and deposit, and even add to that erode, transport and deposit such a vast amount of sediment in say 5 months' time? You can just do the numbers, and you find that you need if you have a layer of water, you need to have you need roughly 50 feet of sediment in suspension at all times, moving at a pretty high rate of speed to deposit that much material. So what conceivable water processes could accomplish that? So what I did, this was a paper I gave last summer at the seventh International Conference on Creationism. And what I did was I took the theory of open channel flow, which is engineering, a theory used by engineers to model flow in channels and flood plains. It's and engineers have refined it. It's well authenticated by the engineering community. So I take that basic theory, which involves turbulent water. So there's some turbulence theory there, and I consider only one kind of erosion, cavitation, which is a pretty rapid, one of the more rapid types of erosion. So I develop a computer model based primarily on open channel flow, and look at what is needed. Look at what is needed to transport as much sediment as we have in the record. To me, it's, I don't know how I should say it. I'm embarrassed for our community that no one has done this before now. You know, this is such a central aspect of understanding the flood. Why has nobody sought to model that before? I put out an appeal at the end of my talk saying, you know, I'm getting up in years. I need some, it would be nice if some young, bright students could get the vision here and jump on board and extend this work. So far I haven't heard it from anybody. But anyway, so that next week I'm going to be talking about how do we account for the sediment record.
Dr. Baumgardner, I appreciate your presentation. I'm here by either accident or by design, somebody's design, because I was supposed to be elsewhere. I really appreciate the careful work you have done. My question is, were you ever invited by other Adventist universities to present this interesting work? I'm thinking especially about my alma mater, La Sierra University.
Okay. I've presented this work to several Adventist groups over the years. I remember a conference held in, let's see, I think it's Georgia. Is there an Adventist school in Georgia? Southeastern?
Tennessee and Texas.
Tennessee, that's where it was, Tennessee. There was a conference on the flood at your university in Tennessee. I remember a very stimulating time there, where we as a smaller group, and we really looked at these issues in detail at that meeting. And I've known Art Chadwick for more than 35 years. I've had lots of interactions with him. I've been down at your school in Texas. I've talked there. I've spoken there. But I've never spoken at La Sierra that I can remember.
How do you address radiometric dating?
Who's speaking? I'm sorry. Yes, I have a. That was one of the talks I offered Bernard to do. From 1997 to 2005, I was part of a team, a research team, that is known as Radioisotopes and the Age of the Earth, or RATE for short. And we found several independent lines of evidence, of radioisotope evidence, that point to the conclusion that the Earth is thousands, not billions of years old. And the in my opinion, the strongest one is the retention of zircons by zircons of most of their radiogenic helium, which we documented and affirmed. And you know, it's hard to imagine, given, and we also contracted out the measurement of how fast helium diffuses through zircon, and that those measurements indicated that for the zircons we were considering, they could not have retained their helium more than just a few thousand years. And yet the uranium lead age for these zircons was 1.5 billion years. So so yes, I have a talk that I give on that work. I include that. I give a lot of emphasis to that work, to the zircon work. Also, with Paul Geim, we did our own work with coal samples, had them dated, found, reproduced what's already in the literature, as Paul Geim has documented, that essentially all fossil carbon has measurable C14 in it, which is very hard to explain if this material is more than 100,000 years old. So we had coal samples from Pennsylvanian coal, we had Cretaceous coal, we had Eocene coal. They all gave dates on the order of 50,000 years, and not 30 or 70 or 300 million years. So so the evidence is essentially it's well documented in the secular literature that fossil material all through the geological record has significant levels of C14. Which it should not have if it's more than just a fraction of a million years old. Mm. So I have a whole talk on that and other those two points and other points that point to radioisotope evidence for a young Earth.
I'm quite sure I remember you talking here at Loma Linda once too. So
I forgot. Yes, I've spoken several times here. Yeah. Leonard has invited me to. I've spoken several times here at Loma Linda.
I just have brief comments on a couple of things that have come up. One, the gentleman over here who wondered why God messed up the earth instead of just killing us off. I have just a speculative answer. Apparently, the earth was in such wonderful living condition that life was too easy, and so you get all this violence. And perhaps God had to change the earth to make life a little more challenging for us. I had this. One idea. And in terms of the distribution of living animals, in addition to the things that were mentioned here, there's new work among biogeographers where they're finding that the old explanation of plate tectonics controlling distribution doesn't work. And there has to be a lot of just cross-ocean distribution. And there's a book called The Monkey's Journey, which is not a creationist book. It's a biographic book, where it talks about this, animals being distributed on rafts of floating vegetation and all kinds of stuff. So that's changing quite a bit.
Thank you. Thank you, Leonard, for those two excellent points. Okay, question up front.
I'm close enough to just sneak a comment in, but I really appreciate your explanation of how these plates moved around. What I'm puzzled by is why they should. And the first time I thought about the plate tectonics was when I was watching how the tires were being balanced on the wheels. It's because the Earth is actually not stationary. It's spinning. It's moving. And so you, after the entire tumultuous reorganization of the Earth during the flood, there had to be a rebalancing somehow of some surface structures. Does that seem reasonable to you?
Well, the Earth basically automatically, since it's a free spinning body, it essentially automatically rotates around its center of mass. Yeah,
but there is still a residual wobble now. I imagine that
The wobble
at the time of the flood, the wobble could have been a lot bigger.
If you actually look at the magnitudes of these forces, it turns out that they are small relative to the forces that are pulling the plates around. It turns out, because I've explored that. And those forces are small.
Second question. Now, you described that all these plates moved around during the flood. Am I correct?
Yes.
Yet, in the Bible, it talks about the earth parting sometime after the flood. And they even named someone.
It's in the days of Peleg, the earth was divided.
That's right.
Okay. I think it's in the fifth generation after Noah, I recall. So what is that word, what is being alluded to? It's approximately at the time of Babel. So was it a political division, or was it a division of mankind as a result of Babel? Or was it a physical division? Well, I believe that the case is overwhelming that all of this motion that I was talking about had to take place during the flood. So it can't be referring to the main divisions like the break of Pangaea. That simply doesn't fit, doesn't work. So the obvious thing is that it has to do with the scattering of people, of language groups, of people groups around the earth, dividing the earth among the various language groups.
In your model, you proposed that there were these regions of colder surface structures, which therefore triggered the entire process. Yeah. What do you propose could be a cause for that?
That's a good question. The Genesis 1 is very brief on how God actually fashioned the earth physically, prepared it for life. On day 3, it says, God said, and let the water that has been below the expanse be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. That's just a few words about that. Okay? But if you're that in itself, however, implies a lot of tectonic activity. It would seem. All right. So, and it talked about the waters being together in one place, and it would be suggestive that the land might also have been gathered together in one place. I don't want to say too. Get off too much here, but if one looks at the chemistry of rocks, the chemistry of rocks by the secular world has been studied intensely. The rocks erupted as lava from the oceanic islands. The the rocks we get along the mid-ocean ridges have been compared across the Earth. There's all kinds of analysis of the chemistry of rocks to try to understand the history, the physical history of the Earth. There's a huge contrast between the chemistry of the continents, of the continental rock, and the mantle rock. And it appears, I'll say that granite is a very special kind of rock. As far as we know, there's no hint that there's granite on any other planet or moon or any other body in the solar system. That some kind of very special process produced the granite that is on the Earth. So, and it appears there's a set of elements, they're called lithophile elements, that are concentrated in the continental crustal rocks the upper mantle rocks especially are depleted in these very same elements. It looks like the continental crust is complementary in chemical composition to the upper mantle, as if some process went on to extract the continental crustal rock out of the mantle. Okay, so there are clues that God used process to fashion the Earth. Okay, biggest body of data that I would point to is the chemistry, especially the chemistry of the continents versus the chemistry of the mantle. And God could have just instantaneously created the Earth the way it was. That's certainly a possibility. Or maybe most of the Earth was just suddenly spoken into existence and appeared. And then the gathering of together of the waters below the firmament was just a minor little detail afterward. So in the scripture, I don't think scripture itself doesn't really give us enough information to distinguish among the possibilities. But as we look at the chemistry, it appears to me that God used a lot of process to create the Earth. That there's a record, there's a history, there's a chemical record of and especially as far as the granite is concerned, you have the radioisotope age of the granitic crust is not a single age. It's a span of ages. It would look like he created the granite crust in pulses and added to it around continental nuclei, added to it around these centers. And so the age of granite in the southwestern United States is markedly younger than what we see in New England and Canada. And so I think I've already forgotten your question. Anyway, I'm saying that the process, God used a lot of process, it appears, to fashion the Earth. It had to be very rapid if we understand the days to be normal days, and I do. So this unfolded rapidly, but nevertheless there was a lot of process that God used to make it happen. Do you remember what the question was that got me off on all of that? Okay.
You covered it, evidently. All right. You know, in Revelation 14, it talks about a creation movement in the earth that'll be worldwide. And then the harvest of the earth is pictured. So here are, it'll be cataclysmic, with the second coming of Christ and every person on earth has heard the everlasting gospel. What is happening in the creation movement really now, the science-backed creation? As far as really linking that with the worship of the Creator God.
Okay, well, my assessment is that most of what God is doing at this present moment is beyond the awareness of certainly most people, but even most Christians. We're not aware of all of the many ways God is working in rural India, you know, remote parts of China, through in many parts of Africa, South America. There are things, significant things God is doing in general that most of us have only a little inkling of happening. And I would say, even though I'm in the creation movement, I suspect there are things going on. I won't say suspect. There are things going on that I'm certain I'm unaware of. And in particular, I'm daily, I get friend requests, either from Facebook or LinkedIn, people I've never heard of before, but if I look at their profiles, they're seriously engaged in creation work. So I just say that to say that God is, he's got his plans, he's calling people, and I only just pick up little inklings of what is going on. But I'm encouraged. There are quite a few young people that are getting involved in seriously reading like the things I've written and scouring the internet to learn all they can. So just where all that's going to lead, I don't know. What I would like to see, though, is people getting higher level training so that they can engage in serious creation research rather than just creation apologetics. I have to say that I don't want to, God is even doing things on that front, but not as much as I would like. I'm basically mentoring a Korean believer who's working on a PhD, wants to do flood work, wants to basically follow in my footsteps. So I'm quietly, patiently mentoring him. But that's just one person, and I could imagine it'd be exciting if there were 20 like him. But at this point, there's just one.
There's many different creation science organizations. There are no doubt national and international conventions. But are these annual?
Most of the conventions are geared for lay people. So as far as training people to be effective in articulating the creation position, I'm sure these conferences serve to do that, but I think my perception is that where that's going on mostly is people with access to the internet that God has put it on their hearts, called them, and they're doing it quietly on their own for the most part, maybe participating in a local or regional creation group. So I have to say I'm not in contact with a huge army of people that are involved, engaged in that way.
I have Two questions, one relating to today's topic and one relating to your next topic. You mentioned the need for supernatural intervention in terms of getting rid of the heat from the molten ocean basins or nearly molten ocean basins. I'm a research scientist and interested in numbers, statistics. How big a supernatural intervention is required in terms of orders of magnitude are is my first question. My second question relating to your upcoming topic is that in addition to the 5,000 feet of fossiliferous strata, there is, and I've had the privilege of floating down the Grand Canyon and looking at it, there's about 15 or so thousand feet of Precambrian that's tilted on its side. Are you, did the flood lay down all 20,000 feet, or is the 15,000 feet of non-fossil bearing Precambrian strata pre-flood by some process? Your calculations will take in both, one or the other?
Okay, that's a good question, excellent question. Basically, what about the non-fossil bearing Precambrian sediments? And you know, there are places where there's more than 20,000 feet, maybe approaching 30,000 feet.
But here in the Grand Canyon, there's a 15,000 foot deposit underneath the five.
The big one in North America is the belt series rocks that are up in the North Pacific Northwest, Montana, for example, and it appears that thick deposit was right on the edge of what was North America before the flood. It appears that my assessment is that is from Creation Week. That massive deposit is from Creation Week, and so we're the Grand Canyon is not that far from the edge of North America, of pre-flood North America either, and so my position is that those sedimentary layers are not part of the flood cataclysm, and the only other time of that kind of large-scale geologic change, in my understanding, would be during Creation Week.
And orders of magnitude for getting rid of the heat, how big a miracle is required, is my question, in numbers.
Okay. Or you're talking about the kilojoules, or how many joules of energy do we need to get rid of?
No, just how, if you take the most rapid normally understood rate at which it could dissipate and the amount of heat, how
okay.
far out
All right.
are we?
All right. The silicate rock is generally classified as an insulator. It does not conduct heat very well. Just like most ceramics, you know, don't conduct heat very well. So basically, if you're going to remove heat conductively, I even that doesn't work, because there's nothing above the rock. The water can't accommodate that much heat either. So we're not talking about, but I can say that to get the if you're going to remove it conductively, you basically need that factor of a billion. You need to increase the conductivity of rock by a factor of a billion. But I believe the heat has to be removed volumetrically.
10 to the 12th? Oh, no, this is America. 10 to the 9th.
10
to the 9th. I'm British.
Yeah. So 10 to the 9th, but... like I say, I don't believe it was removed conductively.
I have a question of my own.
Are you, in your modeling, do you deal with meteorite impacts, as there are several of them in the geological record, Chelyuskab being the most famous, but there are several that are even larger than that, if I understand correctly.
Well, to be sure, there are impact structures in the fossil bearing sediment record, which implies to me that there had to be a significant increase in frequency of impacts during the flood. But I also see that, well, the two biggest impact structures on Earth are in pre-flood rock. So I believe there were large impacts during creation week. And I believe that the moon had to have been impacted during creation week. Now, I get lots of flack from my fellow creationists. Last summer, just incredible violent reaction to that. But to me, that's the only way the puzzle can be put together in any kind of coherent way. So people, somehow they think, you know, God, it's out of character with God to have used that kind of violence when he created the cosmos and created the world.
You mean they want to put it during the flood?
They want to put it during the flood.
Thanks for coming, Dr. Baumgardner. Two questions I have. One is, I'd like to know a little bit more about your trigger mechanism at the beginning of your catastrophic runaway model. And then the second is to do with the picture you have right here, and that is that, you probably alluded to this a little bit with a previous question from Dr. Bull, was that all that sedimentary rock in a photograph, if that was sediment that was laid down during the flood and then eroded as the water receded, how would you account for consolidation and cementation of that sediment into rock without, and then being eroded without it? If it was still soft sediment, it would have not stood up in the vertical. You're seeing that picture.
Right. Okay, I'll take the last question first, and then you can remind me of your first question. First of all, it's my conviction that the canyon was eroded after the flood, that there were large inland bodies of water still remaining after the main runoff occurred, still present in North America. And after the flood, there was a lot of tectonic adjustment, just how long after the flood, whether it was decades or a century or more, there was these lakes overtopped a dam and in just a few weeks' time emptied through and cut the canyon. So by that time, it would seem that there was enough time for cementation of that rock to take place. Now, what was your first question?
First question was about the trigger mechanism for your runaway model.
Yeah, and now I remember the earlier question. What about the distribution of coal material? I'll try to weave those both together. If there was a single supercontinent, it's certainly plausible that there was some mantle overturn involved as God fashioned the Earth very rapidly, to be sure, and so if that granitic material was being collected together, there would likely be a convective overturn of the mantle, and it could well leave some cold material around the periphery of that original continent. Now, now let's assume that took place, and you had cold, negatively buoyant material circling the supercontinent. There's going to be a tendency for that material to want to sink, and so it's possible that, and also there is a significant mineral phase boundary at about 660 kilometers depth. And it turns out that phase transition is what's called endothermic. In other words, it takes additional heat for the rock, for those minerals to change phase. So that boundary presents a barrier to flow. So even today, there's evidence that coal rock that's sinking from the Earth's surface is piling up on that boundary. So what it's conjecture, but that there was some material that had accumulated there, had piled up on the boundary. It was continuing to sink during the time between creation and the flood, and that process could have been building during that 600 or 1600 or so years, and it just at the time of the flood, it reached the point where the runaway kicked in. So it could have been that. So I'm for one thing, I'm saying with a fair degree of confidence that there was some kind of a built-in provision that this kind of cataclysm could occur at the end of creation week. Whether it was actually moving toward that cataclysm, I don't know, but it may well have been let go when Adam fell. So I believe there's physical reasons for that kind of initial condition that I used, and that initial condition just by itself it needed no further trigger. It could have just triggered itself. A lot of people like to invoke meteor impacts, and so I can't rule out some impact being part of the triggers either, but my preference is not to invoke that unless I just have to. Okay, well, I think you're okay.
We have one last question.
All right. Okay, it's my understanding, you're talking about Pangaea, the big supercontinent, but a number of other creationists, I think, believe that the water was under the earth, was under the ground, so there's a lot more ground probably than there was water before the flood. How does your theory mesh with that one, or do they totally disagree?
Okay. The main issue is what about water or water chambers in the earth prior to the flood? I'm aware of there's a number of scriptures that can easily be understood in those terms. Just as a geophysicist, I have some difficulty, because those kind of if you have a significant body of water at depth in the earth, it's going to be strongly gravitationally unstable. It's going to be extremely buoyant. It's almost going to require supernatural provision to keep it from breaking out to the surface. If basalt, which only has a few percent difference in density when it's molten, if it can find cracks and find its way to the surface with a little difficulty, water, which has a lower viscosity and a much larger density contrast, it's gonna be easy for water to find weaknesses and cracks and ways to get to the surface. So from a basic physics standpoint, I have difficulty with such bodies. Of course, Christians who believe in the power of God, they can easily dismiss those arguments. Okay. I would say today, as far as looking for any such bodies that remain, seismically we're able, a lot of the earth has been looked at seismically. And as far as I know, there's no clue, no hint of any such bodies of water being in the earth today. And so, and my model does not require them. The fountains of the great deep are what I described in my presentation. I believe that there's no problem with the Hebrew in this interpretation. And on the other hand, let me hasten to say, I don't rule out that there were not some chambers of water in the earth prior to the flood.
Because they did have rivers before the flood, and if there's no rain, then the water had to come from someplace to flow down to someplace.
Yeah. Well, the argument that there was no rain before the flood, I don't just automatically accept that. It talks about in Genesis 2, I think verse 4, about there was no man to till the ground, so God, there was a mist that rose up and watered the face of the ground. But that was, and then it gives the account of God making Adam and Eve. So that the context of that brief verse, it seems to be before, it would have to be during creation week before man was on the earth. So I don't know what to make of that verse, but I personally. I'm not convinced that there was not any rain before the flood. I don't think there was the violent thunderstorms that we have tend to have today. But I don't rule out the possibility. I mean, it would seem like there was almost certainly had to be evaporation from the ocean surface prior to the flood, given just the temperature structure of the atmosphere, almost certainly some topographical variation. You know, there were mountains before the flood. I would see it would seem like to me it would be hard for there not to be rain, not to have been rain before the flood. So, that's all I can say. I don't know, my guess would be there was rain before the flood, and the rivers were formed from rainfall.
We want to thank you very much for coming and for sharing with us.
I'll just say I appreciate such a attentive audience, so many good questions, and such good interaction. So it was very enjoyable for me.